Chief of the Hellenic Air Force, generals, distinguished guests. Cyberspace is inevitable, a new field of conflict where various actors are engaged, and as Professor Giannakogiorgos previously mentioned, armed forces can be highly affected in multiple ways. In my presentation, I will walk you through various potential attempts in the mobile and social environment that can seriously affect our personal and professional life. So my focus in the presentation will be the human beings of the armed forces. Whatever you will see here as a threat, it can be used as an offensive weapon against potential enemies. So, many of us have Facebook profiles. We are using Twitter either to learn the news or to express our opinion. We have Instagram accounts where we post photos of our life, personal or even professional. We use smartphone devices. We have fitness trackers, smartwatches, and also we use various applications to make our life easier, for example, to track the progress of our exercising. But are we aware of all the risks per training, the use of them? These are the questions I will try to address today in my presentation. Whatever you will see here, all the cases comes from open data that can be found in the web. So I have not used any information that has any level of classification. So if we see the data out of context, we cannot understand what they mean. Here you can see data from activity trackers. Of course, you cannot identify the place. But now that you can see the satellite image, you can see the building that we are inside. Okay, what we can get from this is where our cadets run and our officers. Okay. If we use other data in other areas, you can see there are places with high activity. Here we can see again the satellite image. We cannot understand where this place is because there are no any other indication or buildings. So what we can do is to go to Google Maps and try to find the specific place. We come up with the name of the country, the name of the area, and some coordinates, but again, we don't have any specific information. For privacy reasons, I have removed the real name of the area. So, by checking a little bit more carefully the specific image, we can say that, okay, this is probably a university, it can be a stadium, or it can be a hospital, or a military base. Going back to Google search engine and using the name of the area, Dreamlands, and adding the word military, you know, we can find easily that indeed this place is a military base. If we search Instagram, again with the same name and the appropriate keyword, we can find that this place has specific types of weapons. Okay, so if we want to target the specific area, we know exactly where we need to hit. Now, what other thing is interesting is that the specific two photos comes from the same profile. So it should be someone who exposed, you know, his personal life over the web. So what we can do is to search further inside his profile, and this is what I found. I found his name in his uniform. I found his credit card, which is an active one. If you check the specific date, the expiration date is 2020, and also I can find his Facebook account, and thus I know where he works, who his girlfriend is, where he lives, who is his family, and everything. So I can use all this information to attack him, and I will do that later. I will show you some ways. Now, let's see the source of all this data. This data come from a company named Strava. It's the creator of the fitness tracking application, and has published the heat map of the data collected from the activity trackers, and it's open for everyone to use them. And of course, I'm not the only one who examined this data. You can see here a lot of articles, and notice here the Taiwan Missile Command Center was exposed. And also, if you search, you will find many more similar reports all over the web. Now, so what was the problem in all these cases? Was it possible to avoid these awkward situations? The answer is simple, of course. The users had only to customize, you know, the privacy settings of the application. By default, they were not enabled, and as a result, the information were uploaded automatically to the cloud of the company. Enough with the trackers and everything. Let's see what other risks are there for the social internet. This is another image that was posted in an official website. As you can see, Prince William is in the center of the image, the photo. From a first glance, we cannot see something interesting, but if you look a little bit more carefully, you will see that there is a paper with the logon details of an internal service of the Royal Air Force. Of course, this is a service, as I have read, that it's not does not contain classified information. But again, somebody, you know, applying some image processing techniques can make the image sharper. And if somebody spends a lot of time, maybe at the end, he or she could be able to read the username and the password. That image was retracted the same day, but as you can see, it can be found still in the internet, the original one. Now, another case from our life here in Hellenic Air Force Academy. This is a photo from an exercise that took place back in the winter. Here we were about to publish this photo to our website in order to advertise the cadets' activity, but we found out that there are a lot of information, not only about the technical details of the image, the date or the camera, etc., but also information about the exact location. So we forgot about publishing the specific photo. And we said that it's better to not disclose that kind of information over the web. So let's move now to the social media and see how Hellenic Air Force personnel use them. What I did, first I wrote some program, some code in a programming language, Python, and I collected all the information from Facebook and LinkedIn that were referring the name of Hellenic Air Force. For example, people who work in Air Force, Hellenic Air Force, or people who have studied in Hellenic Air Force Academy or in other schools of HAF. I came up with several accounts. Actually, to my estimation, it should be 27% of the personnel of Hellenic Air Force. And from them, 89% are men and 10 women, which is something that we expected. In some cases, had information, the profiles had information about the exact specialty and the position in Air Force. You can see here 30 were meteorologists, 74 retired air traffic controllers, pilots and engineers share that. 5% of the profiles also revealed information about the spouse. So I know who is married with whom for a small percentage of them. And 72 shared information about their actual place of residence. Interestingly, many of them have also published information about the military units they serve. So you can see some numbers here. In LinkedIn, the participation seems to be higher. LinkedIn is a professional social network, so we can find a lot of people having their profiles. Actually, to my estimation, again, it should be around 52%. Again, LinkedIn is a little bit different than Facebook. It doesn't allow you to search in depth all the profiles. You have to pay for that. It is about, I think, around 800 euros in order to allow you to search all the profiles. So it gives you a free search for only 100 profiles. But using, again, our friend, Google Search Engine, I was able to collect more than 1,400 profiles. The sample has a similar percentage in men and women. I found the same specialties, meteorologists, retired ATC controllers, pilots, engineers. Again, information about the military units as in Facebook. And cross-checking the data I collected from both social networks, I managed to identify the same names and the same persons in 267 profiles. So this means that I can collect even more information about them. So, having all this information, applying some known algorithms from social network analysis and especially centrality measures, I can calculate the degree centrality, which will give me, you know, the nodes that have a lot of friends, or the between centrality, the important nodes, those that connect different social networks, for example, different compact wings. I can calculate closeness centrality, the nodes that can easily distribute information, or the eigenvector centrality, nodes that that have important friends. So if I want to spread a rumor, for example, I will target people with high closeness centrality, or if I want to disrupt a social network, I will select to target people with high between-witness centrality. And by using community detection, I can find more people in the same compact wing, since the community detection shows the interaction between the different nodes of a social network. So, based on the collected information, I can prepare my social engineering attack. I can create a fake social network. I can borrow photos from real profiles, and I can create my own personas. I can make friends, one with each other, all of my fake profiles. So I will create a small fake social network. And then I can target somebody, let's say a married pilot. I will send him such a request, a friend request. And you know, most of the people, usually what we are doing when we're receiving such a request, we check if this is a real person. And how we do that, we see if there are many friends or if it is an active account, and if there are many photos. So since I have already prepared my social network in that way, nobody can understand that this is a fake profile. So most of us, or a great majority, will accept the request. And then we can start sending messages, intimate messages, progressively, and then it is too late, especially if there is a family. Okay, we have been hacked. Actually, this is a serious case of social engineer attack. It is something that we cannot easily manage alone. So, how we can use the social media? The solution is not to use them, but to follow specific guidelines, as those are can be found in various documents in Department of Defense, the Greek Department of Defense, the Hellenic, and also in other defenses. What is important here is that we need to discuss also with our family, so not only avoid posting things, but also our family should be aware of the dangers. So, what else can social engineering do to us? As Kevin Metnick, a very known security expert and social engineer, said, it is something that getting people to do things they wouldn't ordinarily do for a stranger. So, as I was preparing my presentation, I had this idea how I could attack the participants of an Air Force conference. So I came up with the following idea. What I would have done is to create a USB stick. I would print a logo of a well-respected company in the surface of the USB sticks, and I would have left the CDs somewhere inside the conference with some materials, let's say a PDF file, having some information that is of interest to the audience of an Air Force conference. And then let's see a short video with the results. Here I am the victim, so I took the USB stick, I connected to the computer, and one of my cadets was the attacker. As soon as I opened the file, there was a notification in my student's computer that somebody was connected. So he started collecting information about the person who used the USB. You will see in a minute that he opened the webcam so he could see my whereabouts, so where I was. You will see my lab behind. Then he took a photo. He can use the photo to create a fake entrance permit or something else, or a passport or whatever. Then he could see, by taking screenshots of my screen, he could see whatever I did. I was writing something about NATO. He saw the keywords and decided that he would like to download it. Now he downloads the document to his computer, and he can either send the document to somebody else, WikiLeaks maybe, or whatever, and expose whatever my job was. So I'm going to go further. How it is possible to avoid such situation? Of course, by not opening USB sticks from unknown sources. Now, let's go a little bit faster to the mobile device, what we need to know about them. I'm not sure if you're aware, there are applications that are companions to the soldiers that serve their military service. So you can see here a very helpful application. It can provide information about the military ranks, about the military units, and also the most important for the soldiers is that it counts the days left till the completion of the military service. As you can see, it's very popular, more than 100,000 downloads, and also you can see the access right that the specific application requests. Okay, this is very dangerous because, you know, if the creator of the application has access to the location of the device, for example, a sentry or a fuel tank, then it's very easy this information to be leaked to somebody that we don't want. And it's not the only one. There are other less popular with less access rights, but with a note that in case we update the app, it may request more rights. Okay, and there is one for Air Force too, for Air Force soldiers. Now, this is the last slide. What we have done, again, with the students is we took an open source game and we injected malicious code. The game is called Jump Don't Die. And with this malicious code, we can infect mobile phones and we can get information about the contacts or the SMS, and we can send also SMS. So we have implemented a functionality when somebody calls us or the victim, then after 5 or 10 minutes, he will get an SMS. Oh, I forgot to tell you that there is a fantastic game you should download. And in that way, we can infect more people in the network of our victim. So what we need to do to be aware of, first of all, we need not to share sensitive data in our phone. We should avoid connecting to open free Wi-Fi spots or Bluetooth spots, and we should not trust anybody else. Thank you for your attention, and sorry for passing the time.